Okay. We want to say good morning and welcome you on this Palm Sunday. This is our fourth Sunday we've been meeting in this fashion, and we're grateful that we have the opportunity to do that, and with technology that the Lord's allowed us. I'd just like to make a couple of quick announcements and then go to prayer. The first is on our giving now. We're kind of behind on all technology as far as giving goes, but now we're up with the online giving, which we didn't have before. But also it's been separated, so we have our missions giving again. So our missions giving on this Sunday will go to Pastor Ron Jones, who did the parenting seminar yesterday, spent the day with a bunch of our parents and online and doing that seminar. And it's also been recorded as well. And so you could really get a hold of that if you want to. Pastor Ron Jones is from Philly. He did a marriage conference for us back in the fall. Just a great brother. And I understood from my daughter husband that they loved the parenting yesterday. And so you can get a hold of that. But our missions giving is going to bless him and just thank him for his time and his giving to us. All our Zoom meetings are available in all the different aspects, the youth group, Friday night prayer, Tuesday morning prayer Monday to Saturday from noon to 1 o'clock, our men's meeting on Saturday morning, our ladies' meeting on Thursday morning. And if you want to get involved in any of those, all you need to do is contact Nikki, N-I-K-I, no caps, that's N-I-K-I at CCIOG.org, and she can get you linked into any of that stuff that you might want to do that. And then this Friday, Good Friday, we'll be having a service on YouTube, which is our regular teaching Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings. And on Good Friday, it will be on YouTube as well. It's at 7 o'clock, and so if you'd like to join us as we center on the Last Supper, that Seder that Jesus had with the 12 disciples, and we want to take a look at that and all the power and the life that our Lord gave us there and all that he accomplished. And so that will be this Friday evening at 7 o'clock. And so we want to look to the Lord in prayer. We have a number of requests. We can continue to pray for our sister Tracy. Her mom Linda went home to be with the Lord this week, and we want to just pray for her and for God's comfort. Our sister Kathy, who's undergoing chemotherapy. Our brother Jimmy Delaney, who has the virus. He's positive for the virus. We want to pray for him. Our good brother Rudy Migliori, who is in Stony Brook on a ventilator right now, and we just want to pray for his healing. Rudy does not attend our fellowship, but he's a Christian attorney, and over the years he's been a great help in a lot of ways. In outreach to people with different needs, and he's just stood with us and helped us and sacrificed as unto the Lord in assisting us in some of the ministries that we've been involved in, and we're just grateful for that. Also, our brother Roger, his sister and nephew, both are positive with the virus as well, so we want to pray for them. We want to pray for our sister Deb and her mom Betty, and Betty, who's very ill, and just Deb is unable to see her, and so we want to just pray for Betty this morning and Deb as well. We want to pray for Sonny and Darlene and their health issues. I want to remember all the medical people that are laboring in the midst of the virus and lift them up to the Lord, our first responders, police, and firemen as well. Also, I want to pray for STBI, which is the trucking company that has faithfully given us food over the last, I think this November will be 7 years. And just in the virus and with them traveling around, delivering food and all that they do, just to pray for them, pray for health for all those that are working there. And just our thanksgiving to them for all the food that they have given to us and helping us feed those that are in need. We're grateful for their hearts and just the way the business operates in honoring Christ. And so we want to lift them up to the Lord. And we want to remember to pray for our brothers and sisters in Uganda and our brothers and sisters in Ukraine as well. Just a lot of needs. It's certainly many more. But we want to just look to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you for this time that we can pray and just join our hearts together in faith. We lift up Tracy to you, and we pray, Lord, that you will give her great comfort and grace with the passing of her mom. We thank you for Linda. We thank you for her life. We thank you how she loved you and served you, Lord. And we're so grateful that she is with you this morning, Lord, that, Paul the Apostle said, it is far better to be with Christ than to remain in this world. And so, Lord, we are grateful she is with you. She is safe. There's no more pain or suffering, Lord, that she's in your presence. And so bless her daughter, we pray, Tracy, and lift her up today and be close to her. Carry her through this time of grief and loss. And we pray for our sister Kathy, Lord, as she undergoes a chemotherapy, that you would heal her, that you'd keep her strong, that you would lift her up and bless her husband John and their family during this time. And Lord, we just pray for our sister, pray for her healing and your hand upon her, Lord. We pray for Jimmy Delaney. We just thank you for him and the great blessing he's been to us, Lord. Our fellowship, his heart for children, his heart for prayer in his time of need. Lord, we pray that you would heal him, that you'd bless him and raise him up, Lord. And we pray for Rudy, Lord, our brother in Stony Brook. We pray for his healing as well. We thank you for him and how he has helped us and stood with us and blessed us. And Lord, in his time of need, we pray for his healing. Lord, bless him, we pray. Bless his wife, his daughters, and family. Lord, we lift them up to you and pray your hand be upon them. Bless Roger's sister, Joanne, we pray. We lift her up to you and her, Roger's nephew as well. We pray that, Lord, you would heal them both and work in their hearts spiritually. Lord, ministering to them, drawing them close to you, we ask and pray. And for our sister Betty, Lord, we pray for her. We pray that even now she would sense your presence and your nearness and that you would be close to her in every way as you promised, Lord. We know you are. And we pray that you would bless Deb and, Lord, that you would comfort her in the absence and separation from her mother. Lord, just be near to her and give her peace, we pray. Bless Sonny and Darlene, Lord. You know the health issues and all that they have been facing over the last months. And Father, we just pray for them. Pray for strength for them. Pray for healing for them. Your hand upon their lives, Lord. And we thank you for all the medical people that are laboring, Lord, particularly Maria, Lord, that's in the city hospital, that's caring for people, and Jimmy's wife, Sue, in Stony Brook there, caring for those that are sick. And Lord, we pray for Sydney and St. Mary's and West Palm Beach, Lord, those that we know, but those that we don't know, Lord, the nurses and the doctors, have your hand upon them. Bless them most of all spiritually, we ask, and bless them physically, Lord, with protection. Have your hand upon them, Lord. And for the first responders, Lord, the firemen and the police, Lord, we ask that you would bless and be with them and have your hand upon them. Keep them safe and close to you, Lord, and bless them spiritually. We thank you for STBI in Lancaster, Lord. We're so grateful for this business and the hearts of the men who own it and run it. And, Lord, how they love you, how they love people, Lord, how Christ is first to them, Lord. And Lord, we just pray that you'd watch over them and protect them and keep them during this time, Lord, as they care for people. Lord, bless them with protection and health and strength, Lord. Thank you for them. Thank you for their giving hearts over the years to us and standing with us and helping us. And we lift up our brothers and sisters, Lord, in Uganda and Ukraine. We pray, Father, for them. We pray for their protection. We pray, Lord, that you would bring healing to them. We pray that you contain this disease, Lord, and that you'd move and work by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you'd bless these people spiritually as well. Lift them up, Lord, I pray, and use the believers just to share the love of Christ with those who don't know you, Lord, those on the outside, those who may be being destroyed by sin. Father, use your people, your children, to bring light and life into the darkness, Lord, where they live. And we're so grateful, Lord, that that's what you do, that's who you are. And even as we remember, Lord, this season, this time of year, Lord Jesus, that you came to bring life into this world 2,000 years ago. And this Palm Sunday, Lord, you were acknowledged as the Messiah. You came to bring life. You came to save us, to rescue us, Lord, to heal us, to deliver us. Thank you, Lord, for your heart, the good work that you have done, and the good work that you are doing and will do in the future as well. And so, Lord, I pray you bless each person that is listening today. I ask and pray that your hand be upon them, Lord. I pray especially for those that might not know you, and I ask, Lord, that they'd come to that place of knowing Christ, Lord, and just have a living relationship with you. I thank you, Lord, for who you are and how you love us, Lord. And I pray that you pour out your spirit upon us today and that you'd meet us here, Lord, and bless this time we have now. In your word, I ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And so this morning, let's open our Bibles to Luke chapter 21. Last week, we were continuing in Romans 15, and I almost thought about just doing that and not veering off to Palm Sunday, but I decided that I'd put that on hold. And so the whole message last week was on Luke 15, and we then took it into looking at the Holy Spirit, looking at the positions of the Holy Spirit, and there's a lot more teaching that's contained in what we call that Last Supper discourse. And so after the week after Easter, we're going to pick up on that again and then continue on through the book of Romans and with God's help finishing it. But we want to really spend some time on the Holy Spirit and the importance of that. But this morning we're going to take a look back at the triumphal entry. And we're going to look at, it's in other Gospels, but we're going to look at Matthew chapter 21, and we're going to take a look there in just a moment. And we're going to see all that took place here and with what we call Palm Sunday and the triumphal entry. It's interesting, though, because when we really understand Jesus, when we really understand the teachings of Christ, really understand God's word, it is radically different from the value system of this world. It's kind of sad today that we have a lot of people that will call themselves Christians, and they want to kind of maintain their life in this world. They want to maintain the things that they're doing. They want to maintain who they are and their success, whatever it might be. And then they kind of hear about Jesus, and then they want to kind of bring Jesus alongside, and then they want to kind of use Jesus to somehow help their lives, maybe improve them to some degree, or bless what they're already doing, and they really don't know who Jesus is. And at times, and we have false teaching, which is, you know, Jesus just wants to give you material prosperity, healthy, wealthy, wise, and all that nonsense that goes on. And yet when we understand who Jesus is, who Jesus really is, Jesus is radically different from this world system. According to the Bible, this world is dominated by sin. Jesus came into this world holy and without sin and sinless. And he came to really reveal to us and show us what God is like. And so there's so much of that in Scripture. We're not going to get into all that this morning, but there's so much of that in Scripture where you see the value system of Christ is completely opposite from the value system of this world, totally opposite. And our Lord revealing that to us and teaching and showing us and leading by example and defining all that for us. But oftentimes in my Bible, in the margin of my Bible, Luke chapter 21 is called the triumphal entry. Triumphal entry. The word triumphal entry here, the words mean someone who comes in as a conqueror, someone who comes in victorious, and oftentimes that would be a Roman leader on a chariot with two white horses, holding a golden scepter, having defeated enemies, and comes in with this great victory that's been accomplished that the people are lauding and applauding and rallying and rejoicing and celebrating all that has taken place because of this victory. The interesting thing is, this day is the complete opposite of that. Because what's going to happen here, and Jesus knows exactly what was going to take place. As you look at his earthly ministry, there were different times where people would come alongside and say, okay, Lord, now it's time to lift you up. Now it's time to really get this thing going. Now it's time where people are following you and they're being healed and miracles are happening. Now it's time to declare who you are, that you're the Messiah, and we can get this thing rolling along. And so people wanted to do that a number of times. And Jesus would never, ever allow that to happen. Sometimes he would just walk away. Sometimes he'd go to a different town. But he had a specific timing, precise timing, exact timing, and he wouldn't let anyone push him into doing something at a time that was not the right time. And this now was the right time. Why is it the right time? It's the right time because of the triumphal entry, because of Palm Sunday. What's going to happen is just a few days later, Jesus is going to hang on a cross, and he's going to be crucified, and he's going to be put to death. Now, most of us would never in our minds equate the triumphal, victorious entry with the fact that Jesus is going to die. and put those two things together. And Jesus knew that by declaring himself as Messiah, by taking this stance in this place, by making this public, by having all the people that were present that gathered for the Passover, there were millions of people in Jerusalem that were not there normally, and they all gathered all the people for the Passover, and by those people who had been touched in other places on the outside by his ministry, proclaiming he's the Messiah, Jesus knows exactly what's going to happen, that the religious leaders who are dark souls, who don't know God, are going to want to kill him and put him to death. And therein, I guess, we could digress a little bit just to talk about this for a moment. A lot of times we have ideas, and a lot of times our ideas are not true. And we just think of, oh, we're religion. Our religion is something that's good. It doesn't matter what religion you believe in. It doesn't, whatever religion it is, all religions lead to God. Well, these guys, what they were doing was not leading to God at all. They declared to Jesus and said, we are Abraham's sons. And Jesus said, oh, no, you're not. If you're Abraham's sons, you would rejoice in the day that it is that you have seen me. You would rejoice in the fact that I am the Messiah, I am who he is. But he said, you are not Abraham's sons, you are sons of the devil. And he was a murderer from the beginning, and you are murderers, and they wanted to put Jesus to death. So these religious people were murderers. You're going to say that leads to God? No, that doesn't lead to God. You're just going to say that has something to do with God? That has nothing to do with God. That has to do with the dark, evil heart of people. Now, understand, don't get nervous. I'm not highlighting these guys, and I'm certainly not coming against Jewish people or anti-Semitism or all that stuff, because that's all dark stuff as well. It's all the devil as well. But just to understand the fact that religions, world religions, are responsible throughout human history for killing millions of people. And so you can never point at that and say, that's God. That's not God. That is the God of this world, small g, defined in Ephesians 2, verse 2, the prince of power of the air that now works in a children of disobedience. And he is a God of wrath and destruction and murder that has nothing to do with the true and living God. And it's important for us to understand some of these distinctions. Otherwise, we're going to believe in stuff that isn't real, or we're going to reject God because of things that says it's, they're religious and they are not spiritual at all, and they have nothing to do with the Lord. And in doing so, miss what God is doing in the day and the hour in which we're living. And I believe that God is doing a lot in the day and the hour in which we are living, and he's told us of that in his word ahead of time and showed us that. And it's interesting, too, because when we come to this, when we come to Palm Sunday, as you look at this, there are four books that are mentioned here in relation to Bible prophecy. In other words, before Jesus was going to ride in on that donkey and declare himself as Messiah, before that was going to happen, there were four books in the Bible. One was 1,000 years old. Another one was 700 years old. Another one was 700 years old, and another one was 600 years old. And those four books were all going to talk about this day and this exact moment. We'll see that in a minute. I'm not going to go into all the detail of it, but we'll see that in a minute. This exact moment. So in other words, there were four books in the Old Testament that talked about the triumphal entry, Palm Sunday, what Jesus was going to do, what that was going to look like, and one that even gave us the exact day it was going to happen. And so you look at Bible prophecy and you go, wow. You realize God is speaking to us through his word, and that is powerful. It's powerful as we understand that, and that's exactly what was happening here. And Matthew, he gets into some of that, and Luke, he gets into some of that as well, into that Bible prophecy. But this is a tremendous proof of the authenticity or the reliability of the Bible, that God has spoken things ahead of time, and he's told us things that are going to happen. And he said in the Old Testament, I have done this so that when they happen, you will know that I have spoken. This is my word, and what I said is true. And then God goes on to say, everything he speaks is 100% accurate. In other words, he never makes a mistake. The Lord never, he's not a human being. It's interesting because we live in this culture today where we push God out of school, prayer out of schools, Bible out of schools. I remember 1992, first time I was in Ukraine, big assembly in this little town, a few hundred kids, and a girl stands up. We were there for days, a lot of meetings because the wall had just come down, and they had just gained their independence, really. The wall had come down before, but they had just gained their independence. But this girl stands up in English, only question in English, and says, do they teach the Bible in public schools in the United States? And if not, why not? I spent a half an hour answering that question because we pushed it all away. We've sent that all away. We've turned away from that and said that it's something could be damaging or untrustworthy. And yet, as we look at that, this is a culture that we live in. Okay, all of that's gone. And then what has happened? Well, I got to tell you, as you come off Northern State, down Veterans Highway, my house is on the 2nd Street, Old World's Path. Just before you get to New Highway, there's a gigantic sign that says Palm Reader. And I think she has a special, $10 special. And then sometimes they put out different signs. Come in and get your palm read so that you can know the future. You can know the future. This stuff surrounds us. I remember as a kid growing up, I never saw. I'm sure somebody was in some back alleyway someplace. But as a child moving around with my grandparents and parents driving around, I never saw this anywhere. It's everywhere. Comac Road by Costco. It's there. It's on Veterans Highway. It's there. Another place, Veterans Highway, is there. All around the place. What's going on? People are looking for answers. People want to understand, can God speak to me? And these folks are saying, for 10 bucks, you got it. You got it. But guess what's going to happen? They're not going to be right all the time. They may be hit or miss. They may be right sometimes. But the ultimate goal, if there is really spiritual power behind them, it's not good. It's not good. Which means ultimately it will be destructive, not life-giving. But the Lord, in his word, says, hey, I speak to you. I am 100% accurate. And my word will bring you life. Life, not hurt you, not take away from you. Well, it will take away something from us. It'll take away the sin and the dark things that we have done and the wickedness we have done and the very sin that's destroying us, maybe even right now. He'll take that away. He'll break the power of that. He'll take that away. And in place of that, he'll give us life. That's what the Lord will do. But God's word is trustworthy. The Bible is a book that has over 3,000 prophecies in it. Most of them have been fulfilled. We're going to look at a few this morning that were fulfilled 2,000 years ago. But there are still some that are not fulfilled. What do they revolve around? They revolve around the second coming of Christ, something we call the last days or the end times, or when Jesus will return and judge this world and set up his kingdom on this earth, the last and final thing that he will do. And the Bible gives us specific information about all those things. And it's worthwhile, if you don't believe, it's worthwhile before you reject him, just take a look. Take a look. Check out the evidence. Don't make a decision without the evidence first being examined. Anybody that would be on trial, if they're innocent, they want them to examine the evidence before the verdict comes in. And if you hide that evidence and you keep the truth from people, then you're doing them a great disservice. And it happens at times, and people end up going incarcerated, you know, unjustly, and they're innocent. But the fact of the matter is, God's given us evidence. We don't want to pass the verdict without looking at the evidence, examining it, and going, is this true or is this not true? Is there something here or there's not something here? And taking a look at that. But this morning, Palm Sunday, is where we are. And so let's take a look at Matthew 21 and start in verse 1. Matthew 21 and start in verse 1. Remember, triumphal entry, time of victory, time of conquest. And it's going to take Jesus right to the cross. And now when they drew near Jerusalem and they came to Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples saying, go into the village opposite you and immediately you'll find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say the Lord has need of them, and immediately he will send them. And all this was done that it might be fulfilled. Well, we'll stop there for a second. So Jesus is saying, okay, this is going to happen. You know, here's what I need. I need a donkey. He needs a donkey because the prophet said, Zechariah said, that he, the king, would ride in on a donkey. So that needs to be fulfilled. But as you look at this, Jesus is taking care of all the little details. All the little details. Every little detail that needs to be taken care of, he's taking care of. And it amazes me how the Lord does this. That the Lord takes care of big things, but the Lord also takes care of small things. The Lord also takes care of the details so that his will and his purposes will be accomplished. He is in control here. He's in control. And that's where sometimes even as Christians, where we struggle with the fact of us wanting to take control and do things and make things happen, and us waiting upon God and prayer, looking to him, and then asking him to take control, that his will would be done, that his kingdom would come, that the things that he wants to accomplish will be accomplished, not the stuff that we've cooked up, but the things that are his. In a sense, the church of Jesus Christ today has had the brakes put on it. And so the church can't run, can't go, can't do, can't work, can't do this, can't do all these things. It stopped. And so now, as a result of that, we have a lot of downtime or free time. It's interesting, though. We have all these Zoom meetings, you know. Sometimes I feel like I'm more busy now than before. A meeting here, a meeting there, two meetings today, one there, one this, one that, here, there, all these different things. But as a rule, we have more time today than we do normally. And in that time, we have the opportunity of really focusing in on spiritual things, of really calling upon the Lord, of really waiting upon him, of really praying and saying, Lord, what do you want to do? What is it that you want to accomplish? And guess what the Lord will do? The Lord will accomplish his will and his purposes as we look to him, wait upon him, pray, and rely upon him. And he'll take care of the big things, and he'll also take care of the small things. The Lord will take care of the details. He'll take care of the details. Why? Because that's just who he is. That's who he is. That's what he wants to do. He wants to take care of the details. And here he's going to be doing this specifically because of what's happening here with Palm Sunday, of course. But the general principle is he does this, you know, all the time. Verse 4, all this was done that it might be fulfilled. Here it is. So all this was going to happen this day because God's word was going to be fulfilled. It's a powerful thing. God's word back then was racing to fulfillment to accomplish everything that needed to be done for Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry to take place, and Jesus to be declared Messiah, and Jesus to ride in on a donkey, and all the Jewish people to rally around and sing out of Psalm 118 what they've been taught to sing when Messiah was come, and they're singing that because they believe he is the Messiah and he has come, and all that's taken place. God's word raced to fulfillment to accomplish that. Why do I say that? Well, because I believe today God's word is racing to fulfillment as well. God's word and all that he has told us is racing to fulfillment. The Lord has not left us without information. Jesus in John 15, the Last Supper, before he was going to be crucified, would say to his disciples, he said, I've told you all things. I no longer call you servants, I call you friends. And I've told you all things the Father has told me so that you know what's going on, basically, my modern language. You know what's happening. You know what's going on. God has told us what's going on today. He has told us. He's told us what's going to happen in the earth. He's told us ahead of time. He's warned us about these things. He showed us. We're watching these things unfold before our very eyes. And so as we look at this, his word is racing to fulfillment. So I could be a person that would say, you know, I don't believe in God. I have no faith. I mean, until I was 23 years old, I was an atheist. I didn't believe in God. I wasn't really an intellectual person, and I wouldn't get really into all the, you know, philosophy, atheist. I just go, I don't believe in God. God doesn't exist. The Bible's a joke. I never read it, but I said it would say it's a joke, and I don't believe. I don't believe that God exists. But all the time, guess what was happening? His word was racing to fulfillment no matter what. His word was active. It was alive. It was living. And it was moving. The key to it all, was I going to acknowledge this? Was I going to bow before him? Was I going to say, yes, Lord, your word is true? Or was I just going to throw it out and do what I want to do? And I had the ability to do that for sure. And my life would have been very different today had I done that, you know, and gone down that road of living for myself. But the result of me bowing before him, acknowledging his word, and that was the thing. See, for me, I didn't know a lot of Christians. I didn't know about different churches and all the different things, movements, Pentecostal and Baptists and evangelicals. I didn't know about all of this stuff. Didn't know about that. But I was wrestling with the Bible. I was wrestling with God's word. And so when I finally came to that place of surrender, it was because of the word of God. It was because of scripture. And so then as that happened, I just moved from Florida back to New York. As that happened, then now you couldn't get me out of the Bible. You couldn't get me out of the Bible because I knew that through the word of God, the Lord was speaking to me personally. I just knew he was. And it wasn't like every day was, you know, some huge kind of thing. But there were some days that it was huge. And other days it would just be spending time in the Word, meditating upon it, feeling as though the Lord was feeding me spiritually, building a solid foundation, showing me the way I was to go, convicting me of things in my life, sin and darkness that needed to go. And I would just go, Lord, I want it to go. Please help me with this. And he'd begin to, you know, change me and do that work. And as I think about that, I realize and I know that there is power in the decisions that you and I make. And when I say that, what I mean is it's power not only to affect us, because certainly 23 years ago, that decision affected me for sure. But what would happen over time is that decision would affect a whole bunch of other people, you know. This week, I put up Jim Delaney on prayer. You know, as soon as I found out, I put it on Facebook, you know, and said, our brother Jim Delaney is in need of prayer. He tested positive to the virus. And Jim has never been to Uganda. Ugandans don't know that he actually paid for a number of people to go. He paid for Kelly Martin to go. He paid for, you know, people to go and sent them and did all this stuff. The Ugandans don't know that. But when they read the prayer request, because they know us, they know our church, they know Calvary Chapel, Island of Grace, they know us, from Uganda, request after request after request came saying, we're praying for him, we're praying for him, we're praying for him, we're praying for him. The decision I made 43 years ago affected what's happening right now. And as all those came. Now, this summer, for the second time, Jimmy did go to Ukraine. And so they knew right away. And so from the Ukraine it comes. We're praying for him. We're praying for him. We're praying for him. And you look and go, unbelievable, you know, that how God is working, what God wants to do. But the thing is, you and I face a decision as to how it's going to go. God's word is racing to fulfillment. Nothing's going to stop it. It doesn't matter that I say I don't believe in it. It doesn't matter. It's going to happen. And we have a lot of proof that it's going to happen from all 2,500 prophecies that have already been fulfilled. 100% accurate, 22,500. That's a lot of evidence. There it is. And so you can trust that the last 500 are going to happen. The question is, where do we stand with that? And the Lord calls us to himself, and he wants us to have a living relationship with him and understand what's happening in the day and the hour which we're living. And his word, God's word, is racing to fulfillment right now, just as it was 2,000 years ago on this day. And so verse 4, all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. This is Zechariah, prophet Zechariah, chapter 9 and verse 9. Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So Jesus was a king, and Jesus was going to come on a donkey. And it's interesting, kind of as you look at this, and you realize the place of humility he took. Jesus, remember how we started? Jesus is radically different from the way of this world. Jesus is God. Jesus created the heavens and the earth. Jesus made everything. Jesus took on the form of a human being and was born of a virgin and came into this world. And he took on the form of a servant. And he did the lowliest things that a person could do, demonstrating the how the heart of God wants to rescue us. See, when we really get that, we're not going to resist that. You go, Jesus did all of this because I am important to him and because he wanted to save me and rescue me from destruction. He bowed as low as you could possibly go, where we all want to stand up. We want to be proud. My reputation, who I am, I accomplished this, I got that, I'm all of this. And we lift all these things up, pride, our pride and arrogance. The Bible tells us that pride is the most serious spiritual sin a person can commit. It was a sin that got Lucifer kicked out of heaven. He used it then on Adam and Eve, and it got Adam and Eve, pride, kicked out of the garden. And it brought sin into the human race, what we're looking at right now. The results of sin, this disease, this virus. Then you go, how horrible is pride? And yet it dominates us. It just dominates us. One thing about the disease, though, that can really happen is it can bring in the hearts of some people just an end to that of going, I'm not so strong, I'm not so powerful, I'm not so bad, I'm not so, you know, but I'm vulnerable, and we all are vulnerable, and I'm weak, and we all are weak. And that didn't change because of the virus. We just didn't believe it. That's what we just keep going with all of that stuff. The virus just brought that to light in some ways, and we look and go, man, I am weak. I am vulnerable. I could be swept away in a second. I can. And the thing is, when you don't have hope and understand who Christ is, the response isn't going to be good. I've talked to some people that are in those, I won't be specific in this, those essential services right now, some in hospitals and whatever. And people who don't know the Lord, they're busted up. And because they're busted up and they're trying to care for people are dying all over the place and all that stuff, how they handle that? They're going out and drinking. They're getting drunk. They're losing themselves in alcohol because the pain of what they're seeing is too much for them to handle. where in that same situation, the person who is a believer, a Christian, can step into that, and into that they can be led by the Lord and bring light and life. But the Lord wants to answer the real deep needs in our hearts and in our lives, and for us to understand and know that it's Him. But here, as we see this, the king comes in as a donkey. Jesus made Himself of no reputation, took on the form of a servant, and He did the lowest things. It's interesting in what we call the Last Supper, which is really a Passover Seder. And again, God's word's amazing, because the Passover Seder, Moses, Pharaoh, children of Israel, delivered out of Egypt, all of that, and all that was established with that Seder, all of that was to point to the Messiah who's going to come, Jesus. Now, we're not going to get into that. We'll get into that on Good Friday, for sure. We'll get into it then. But all of that happened because all of that was to point to the Jesus that was going to come. So when Jesus would have the last, we call it the Last Supper, it was a Seder. He was basically saying, all this that you've done for a couple thousand years, all this, it's of Me. The bread that you've broken over all these years is My body going to be broken for you. The cup that you drank is My blood that's going to be shed for the remission of sins, forgiveness of sins. All of that that was given back then was to point to what was going to happen through Christ. It's unbelievable. The word of God it's amazing. Really, when you look at it, I just got to digress for a second. She had this one thing. In Genesis chapter 22, we see Abraham and Isaac going up to the mountain. And so as they're going, God told Abraham, sacrifice Isaac, your only son. Abraham's ready to do it. And so he's heading up the mountain, and Isaac says, Dad, we have the wood, but where's the sacrifice? You know, and Isaac was going to be the sacrifice, but he didn't know that. But Abraham, in Genesis 22, makes his most profound statement, and I don't believe he even knew what he was saying fully. I don't think he did. But he says this. He says, the Lord will provide Himself a lamb. Okay, normally you would just say, Abraham would say, the Lord will provide a lamb. But he didn't say that. He said, the Lord will provide Himself a lamb. In other words, he's saying God is going to provide a lamb that's going to die and be the sacrifice. God's going to do that. Now, they were making their way up Mount Moriah. 2,000 years later, Jesus climbed Mount Moriah with a cross on His back and was crucified right there. The Lamb of God slain before the foundations of the world to pay the price for all sins, for all people, that and purchase redemption for everyone. And you look at that and go, he was the Lamb. And so when Abraham said the Lord will provide Himself a Lamb, meaning God is going to provide the Lamb that we need, the sacrifice that we need to take care of the issue of sin in our lives. And all of that was pointing to that. And I look and go, No men, no women wrote the Bible. They were not that smart. We're not that bright. You can't link all that together, because the way that's phrased is unbelievable. The Lord will provide Himself a lamb. And you look at that and go, God is amazing, as He shows us this is the way. This is how it's going to go. And then right in that spot, 2,000 years later, the Lamb of God slain before the foundations of the world is going to be put in a cross. He's going to bear our sins. He's going to lay it all down and shed His precious blood, so that we could be forgiven, that we could be cleansed, and we could have a relationship with Him. Just phenomenal stuff. Verse 6. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded. There's a novel concept. What is that saying? It's saying the disciples obeyed Jesus. The disciples obeyed Jesus. We are in the United States, we're in a terrible place as far as the church goes. We are. I've been a Christian. Well, I've been pastoring now 30 years. This is my 30th year. I have seen, on a regular basis, people are coming to church, people that profess they're Christians, somewhere they prayed a prayer with somebody, said something, you know, and they're Christians, and they just do things contrary to the Bible. They'll just do things contrary to the Lord. They'll be living in sexual sin, go, you know, we got a little problem with that. Oh, no, God knows me. Oh, we're saving for a wedding or whatever. They'll come up with something to go, and no, you just have to obey the Lord. And I never have been angry or confrontation with a person on those issues. I'll be loving and gentle. And they'll leave a church. They're gone. And they're going to go to another place and keep moving around because they're not going to obey the Lord. One time I remember I did a thing on taxes. You know, it's not really a complicated thing. Jesus took the coin out of fish. Whose picture's on here? Caesar. Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar. To God, the things that are God. We're supposed to pay taxes. That's all. Very simple. At the end of service, a guy comes up to me and he goes, I don't care what you say, I'm not paying taxes. And I said, listen, I don't say anything. I didn't say anything. Jesus said it. So you want to say to Jesus, you're not going to obey him. Go ahead. Good luck with that. No, I didn't say that to him, thought that. But good luck with that. That's not going to work out in your best interest. You know, but people do that. Just, I'm going to do what I want to do. And be ungodly and be nasty and be hurting and cutting and say things behind people. Christians. See, that's where, to me, this whole virus thing, it needs to work on us first. Judgment will first begin at the house of God. That's us. If we are not spiritual people, and we're not, if we are not loving people, and we're not, if we are not obeying Jesus, Jesus said, if you don't obey me, you're not my friend. And so go, who wants to go down that road? Go, I don't care. I'm just going to do what I want to do. I'll use your name here and there, throw that around a little bit, and I'm just going to do what I want to do. No, obedience is everything. Obedience is everything, just as disobedience and rebellion is everything that will destroy us. Everything that will destroy us. But we have a form of Christianity in the church today where people pick and choose and they do what they want to do and they follow the Lord from some kind of distance and they think they're okay and they're not okay and they're bringing darkness into their own lives and then the darkness into the lives of people that are around them. See, that's the thing for us when we really understand that. Go, how important is it for me to be spiritually right? Well, I'm older now. I'm 66 a few weeks ago. I'm older now, and it's super important for me to be spiritually right. Why? Because I have a wife, and that wife looks to me and depends upon me and loves me, and so it's really important. I'm obedient for her. And then I got two daughters, and those two girls look at me, and the one is married, and the other one's going to be married, and they're both their husbands. They're going to look at me, and then I got grandkids running around, and those grandkids are looking at me too. And obedience in my life is everything to affect the whole family, right at home, affect them. And that's the one thing, you know what, during this time, please, during this time, spend time with your family. Just spend time with them. Because we can all be home. You could be on some kind of devices. I don't even own half them, and I don't even know how to work the one or two I have. Teddy knows all that. But anyway, that's a whole other story. But you could just be on some device. You could be all over the place and totally separate from everybody. That you could just be watching TV here, do this, do that, separate from everybody. No, the Lord wants us connected. If we got this time alone, think of things that we can do in the house that are just loving things. That's all. Just godly things. And it doesn't have to be, spiritual things, of course. But I'm not just saying just sit around and only read the Bible and pray, which is a good idea to do that, for sure, at times. But other things as well. Just give attention, you know. Little Violet and me, man, we're like, you know, we connected. You know, she came first before Angelique was born, and she just turned a year last week. She turned a year old, and she makes some noises, not to communicate much, but I'll just treat her like she's a person, you know, and so I'll pick her up. She's light enough, you know, give it some time. I'm not going to be able to do this, but I'll pick her up, and I'll go, okay, Violet. We got to do some work today. We got the clothes in the basement that need to put in the washer. And I'll take her down, and she'll be looking. You know, I'm throwing the detergent in there. And she's, what is he doing, you know? And she said, oh, we're putting the detergent in. We're washing the clothes. And then let's go upstairs. We got to do some cooking, Violet. Okay, we're going to clean garlic. Now, yesterday I was doing this, and I actually, most of the time I hold her. But I actually put her in her little feeding chair, whatever they call it. I'm blanking out. Anyway, her high chair. And so she's in her high chair. So I cleaned a big piece of garlic, and she was watching me, watching. And I put that, and I said, this is garlic. Now we can dice it up, and we're going to put it in the soup, the sausage potato soup, you know. And so I put that down. She grabbed that big piece of garlic, popped it in her mouth. Ow! And she only has two teeth at the bottom. But she closed the mouth of that. All of a sudden, oh, no, she didn't like that. Out comes the garlic. She made a face. I go, I didn't tell you to do that, you know. But then I did another one. I put the second one down, and she did it again. Grabbed it again. You know, so she likes garlic, I guess. I don't know. But the thing is, I treat her like a person. I talk to her. I show her things. Look at this. Look at that. Look at this. That we need to spend time with our families. We just do. We have a kind of unique time period right now. But let me say this. When this time passes and we don't have all this time now, the only way you're going to spend time with your children, your families, is if you make the decision in your mind and heart that you're going to do that. And then that's a priority, and you're not going to let anything get in the way of that, because that's what I need to do. That's most important. That needs to be central in my life. And you know what? It's that's the most, your marriage and your children grandchildren are the most important ministry that you have. Most important things. Not just run around out there. I'm going to run around out there. Do this. I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that. But that is the most important. A few weeks ago, right, we were driving down to Florida for the G5020. We stopped. I stopped with a brother with me who hadn't been to the Billy Graham Library, so I stopped there with him. And at the end of it, there was a part, I don't know, I think they added some things. They took out some stuff. I remember I hadn't been there a few years. But they had Billy Graham as an interviewer from Fox interviewing him, and he's very old and feeble in a wheelchair, difficulty communicating. But they said, if you could do your life over again, what would you do? And he said, I wouldn't travel around so much. I wouldn't run around. I wouldn't take all the speaking engagements. I wouldn't do this. I wouldn't do that. I would be more at home. And then he said, I'd have more time with the Lord, more meditating on Christ and his word and things like that. And it was just interesting hearing him say that because he had had this notoriety. And so people wanted him to do everything. And he's running around just doing stuff. But meanwhile, there's something he said, his words, more important that I spend time with Jesus. If I could do it over, that's what I would do. And that's where you and I need to be ask those questions. Go, okay, as all this is happening, we're slowing down. I want to look at my life, and I want to pray and ask God, say, Lord, what's the priorities here? What are the most important things for me to be doing, you know, and to make those things central in our lives, and then do them, and then just do them, and not let something else crowd its way in and push it away. For parents, the greatest gift that you can give your child is yourself. The greatest gift that you can give your child is yourself, most important. And to know that as a believer, to know that I want to impact my child spiritually. I want them to watch me. I want them to know my heart. I want to know. The end of June, when we were back in Ukraine, Jimmy was blessed to be able to take his grandson, Patrick, who's in the military now, but take his grandson over to Ukraine and have a time there for the outreaches that we did with the basketball and the meetings in the villages and all different things, and have his grandson there. And his grandson just watched his grandfather. Watch his grandfather's heart, who he was, how he loves the children, ministry, and all that stuff. I believe that's going to have, in Patrick's life, eternal impact. It just will, over time. And he'll look back and he'll know and go, my granddad, he loved this. He loved Jesus. He loved people. He did the Lord's work. He gave himself away to others. That's who he was. That's what he does, you know. And so that's just how it is. Talking about God's word, too, Jimmy has this little thing that he does on Sunday mornings where he sets up a little bagel table because he saw how we had the Christians. He saw how we had the bagels and stuff and the desserts, whatever it is, after service, that the children would be crushed by the adults, you know, spiritual adults that we are. And he realized, I got to get the kids, I got to keep them safe. So he established a table separate, and this table is, this is the children's table. And he made little bagels and snacks and drinks, whatever, this for the children. The adults come, get away, get lost. No, he wouldn't say that, but I would get it. And so he do that. But for every child, he has a little container that has all different scripture verses in it, almost like those pieces of paper you find in Chinese fortune cookies, that size. And so Jimmy would put his hand out and say, if you want a bagel or whatever, snack, take a scripture verse first and read it to me. And the children would take the verse. Now keep that, you know. And he'd do that. What is he doing? He's sowing into their lives the word of God at a very young age. And he's demonstrating to them that Mr. Jim thinks the word of God is really important. And Mr. Jim loves the word of God. And Mr. Jim loves Jesus. And Mr. Jim, he's one of the most loving adults in the church towards children. And they see that, they know that, and that sticks with them. And as you look at those things, you realize this is the work that the Lord wants to do. That's who he is and what he does. And we have to, they're all out from obedience. Okay, so obey the Lord. Verse 6. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt. They laid their clothes on them and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. As we said, this was a multitude that normally wouldn't all be there, but they came in for the Passover, that feast. And honestly, for me and you as Christians, that's the feast that we should keep central at Easter time, because Easter is just the name is from an old pagan holiday with the bunnies and the eggs. It has nothing to do with Jesus, and Passover has everything to do with Jesus. So keep that central there. But they were there, this great multitude. Others cut down branches from the trees and they spread them on the road. And then the multitudes who went out before him and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Now, this was taken out of Psalm 118, verse 26. This was written 1,000 years ago. The children of Israel were taught over all that time that when the Messiah would come, this is what they would be singing. And so now, guess what they're doing? They believe that Jesus is the Messiah. They believe the Messiah has come. And so now they're singing it. And it's important to know this. The word Hosanna means save now. Save now. And at times, you know, in my lifetime, I've heard unbelievers say, you know, well, Christians are saying I need to be saved. Or a Christian is saying that I am saved. What does that mean? And they'll, you know, what are they talking about? And they'll maybe even make fun of it, not understanding it, you know, and say that about being saved. What that means is that Jesus came to save us from our sins. You see, the greatest need the human race has this morning is the need to be saved from sin. Sin, according to the Bible, will destroy us. Sin will bring us death and darkness. It's what Satan will use. It may be a certain amount of pleasure in it for a season, but the Bible says ultimately it will wipe us out. As you look at the world today, what is the problem in the world today? The problem in the world is sin. It's always been. It's never changed. It's exactly the same way. You know, as you look at all that the human race does, it's sin. Why are there babies starving in Uganda? Because of sin. Because there's people have multitude, millions and billions of dollars, and they use it for themselves instead of reaching out and saving the life of a baby who's starving to death. Why? Because of sin, because of greed, because of how we are, what we do. The resources of the earth could care for everyone, but sin is a problem. And sin, it will be the problem, and it is a problem in the world today. But Jesus came to do what? He came to save now. He came to save people from their sins. He came to rescue them from sin, rescue them from the power of sin. And we'll talk about that and go back to that in just a moment. But they were singing this out, verse 10. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? We're going to come back to this too. Important question. Who is this? So there were people who absolutely knew who Jesus was. There were people, I believe, that were followers of Jesus. There were people that had been touched by him. Sometimes I've heard pastors or preachers say stuff like, this same crowd is the ones that yelled, crucify him on Friday. And I don't believe that at all. I don't believe that, not one bit. That crew was set up by the religious leaders of their day. They were paid off. They were bought out. And even the trial was at night, which the trial, according to Judaism, was never to be at night. They did a lot of illegal things. But the fact of the matter is there were a lot of people that were sincerely touched and had spiritual life that were part of this group. And they wouldn't just flip and turn around like that and just say, crucify him, you know, in a few short days. That was not the case at all. And so when he had come to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? Verse 11. And so the disciples said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. And so it's interesting, as you see this, it says all the city was moved. So on Palm Sunday, all the city was moved. On the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was poured out, the city was moved. And when you go down through church history, there have been times of revivals again and again and again where when the Holy Spirit was poured out, people were moved. People were moved. And the result of that was that cultures, societies, cities were transformed, that life flowed, that sin was eradicated as people repented and asked God for forgiveness. And I believe that the Lord wants to do all of this again. I believe he does. And I believe this. The problem is not the people out there who don't know the Lord. The problem is us. The problem is his people, his children. What are we doing? What's our position this morning, our position today? How are we looking at all this? How are we looking? Are we looking at ourselves? Are we crying out to God? Nehemiah, when he cried out about his sin. He cried out about his family's sin. Then he prayed for the sin of the nation. You and I need to be in that position of intercessors. And I believe that the Lord desires and wants to do it again. But they ask this question, who is this? And I would like to just take a moment here as we're getting close to finishing talk about that a little bit. Who is this? Who is this? It's the only one who can save now, save from the power of sin, save from the penalty of sin, save from the destruction of sin, the only one who can give us freedom from sin. And the thing is that when that happens, according to the Bible, according to witnesses in the Bible, testimonies of lives changed, and according to all church history, everything changes when this takes place, when this happens in the life of a person, transformation. And so who is this? The only one who can do that. Jesus is the only one who can do that. Number two, who is this? He came as a suffering servant, and he is coming again as a King of Kings. In the Old Testament Bible prophecy, two pictures. First coming of Jesus, suffering servant. Second coming of Jesus, King of Kings. And so who is this? He came as a suffering servant. He came riding a donkey as a king. He came in humility, and he was crucified. But he's coming again as a King of Kings, and he will be a conqueror then, no longer that. But both of those pictures are given to us in the Bible. Who is this? How would he do this? By that very week, going to the cross, by bearing our sins, by opening the door to relationship with the Lord and eternal life. And so he was going to do this by that very week. At the end of the week, he was going to go to the cross. He was going to bear our sins and give his life. And by doing that, opening a door of relationship with the Lord. Who is this? The Savior of all people, God who became a man, the King who rode a donkey, the servant who came to die for me and you. And that's who Jesus is. Jesus is the Savior of all people. He is a God who became a man. He is the King who rode on a donkey and a servant who came to die for me and you. And as you and I understand this, and you and I see the truth of this, of what took place on Palm Sunday and what took place the rest of the week and all that would take place, the Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday, all that was going to take place, realize Jesus came for this work so that we might have life and that we might be saved, that we might be rescued, and that we might come to know him in a personal way. And so that's really the message of Palm Sunday, that he is the Messiah. He is the way to the Lord. He is the way to the Lord. He paid a price only he could pay. No one else can pay a price for your sins and my sins. Nobody else can. No one else has the power. No one else has the ability. Only Jesus could do that, and only Jesus did do that. And that's why John 3:16 is such an important verse for us. For God so loved the world. Important concept. For God so loved the world. A lot of people think somehow God hates them or God hates people. No, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him by faith, putting their faith in him, should not perish but have everlasting life. That's the key to everything. You and I need spiritual life. You and I need the issue of sin dealt with in our hearts and in our lives. And that's the most important thing. It's the most important thing for us to understand that, to know that, to see the truth that is here. And it's my prayer this morning that if you don't know that, that you certainly will come to know that. And if you need to take a look a little deeper and do some investigating, I'd encourage you to do that. But come to that place that you come to know him who conquered and won the victory by laying down his life and dying on a cross as a criminal in our place. That's what he came to do. That's who he was. That's what he did for us. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for this time this morning. We're grateful for the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit. We're thankful, Lord, that you gave everything for us so that we could have life, that on that cross you bore our sins, Lord, that on that cross when you cried out, "It is finished," the debt for sin was paid once and for all. And Lord, I'm so grateful for that. I'm grateful, Lord, for the power that was released and unleashed there that can flow down to all people everywhere, whoever will turn their hearts to Christ. And so, Lord, I pray for those this morning that you would have your hand upon them that need you and bless them and work in their lives. Reveal yourself to them, I ask and pray. And, Lord, I just pray as well for your church, your people, that, Lord, we would return to you, that we would examine ourselves, Lord, that we would spend time in your word and in your presence, that we would be living lives that are consecrated to you, Lord, lives that you've called us to, death to ourselves, life to Christ, all that you extend to us, Lord, the power that raised Christ from the dead and dwell in us, Lord, that you'd raise us up from the dead. And so, Lord, we pray for that work, for your people, for your church, that we will rightly reflect and represent you in this fallen world. And again, Lord, we pray for those that may be suffering from this virus right now. We lift them up to you, and we ask your hand be upon them. I ask that you'd bless them and bless their loved ones and their families, Lord. Have your hand upon them, we ask and pray. Pour out your spirit upon them. And Lord, we just thank you for this time, and we commit ourselves into your hands. Lord, lead us forward in your will and in your purposes, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.